programs. Right now we're productionizing. So I like to use JupyterLab to prototype the code. It's fast in that interactive environment. But eventually we are going to have to move into the script. So we'll collect them into the script. It'll still look kind of messy, and over the course we'll clean it up. So in case I cut out, which I don't know at which point I cut out, I was saying that there's a book called Clean Code, the philosophy I like to practice. So Clean Code, and so what does clean code mean? It means that you can read them, read your own code again, and or anybody else can read your code and understand what it does. So there's two basic principles to that I like to follow, which is keep your variable names descriptive, so that, you know, minimize the comments and have descriptive variable names. Some people like to write a lot of comments. I like to minimize the comments and make the variable names itself descriptive. And second, have your functions fit into a screen. If it doesn't fit into a screen, that means you need to split your function. So we're going to go into this process. So ideally, let's envision what we want in the end. So user clicks the CrossCompute button in JupyterLab, which triggers running the command line script in the same folder as the notebook. So this we've already solved before, just restoring that. Find the configuration file in that folder. Run batches if displays output, or show input form if displays input. This, I think, well, either way, it'll start up the browser. There'll be an index page. Server starts up. Eventually, so this will be new, showing live output in the browser instead of in the JupyterLab dialog, which is cool, but I think browser will enable more parallel live output. I mean, technically they're kind of equivalent. It's fun to watch the parallel run. And auto download PDF batch if so this requires some separate printer process. I don't know if this we should include in the open source part. Anyhow, I think within 30 minutes you'll watch us productionize the scripts for 4 through 5. Let's do that. So we're assuming the config file path has been found. And like I said, as an artist does, the first sketch is messy, and successfully clean up the messes, but the most important thing is to get something working, and then once you get to that point, you just make it work better. So that's engineering principles. Okay, so let's get the arguments. We should probably write pseudocode first. So we're going to get the configuration path. Load configuration. We should get the script command, our script configuration, also the batches configuration. To run the batches, we don't need to know the input variables actually. We should probably launch in a separate thread. That way we can get the browser up. But for now, let's make it synchronous. So it's one thread. So the browser will come up after the batches are done. Could record that thought in a to-do. Now the question is if the batches should be in the main thread or in a child thread. I think it should be in a... That depends. Not sure. Okay, so then run each batch, and there's also server process. Start server. So each of those batches will be a route. Well, we need to define the routes and views, so we're going to use pyramid. And I think that's it, right? So we know all the pieces of this puzzle, and we're going to put it together now. And we'll use our prototype scripts as reference. Alright, so we wrote the pseudocode. I always like to write the pseudocode first. Helps me to stay on track. Alright. Let's go to our converted files. I think the first one would be restore functionality. Yep. So we're going to get the config path straight up from the console. Just check. Like I said, you make it work. So you're going to start with a base of something that works. So you see, even if it's super simple, it works. And then the idea is you just change it into a more working. Alright, so let's get the configuration path. Run each batch. So we'll start by running the first one. I like to prototype each part of the loop individually first, and then put it in the loop. It helps to speed up debugging. Alright, so we have our batch configuration. Let's get a specific one. Batch configurations. All right, so to run each folder, let's get the run. Okay, so we have AOS telling us what work we need left. Okay. Input and output folder. Let's get, we're just prototyping a single batch right now. So, in pyramid. So this simple server has problems. We need to use waitress, but we'll do that later. So we're just setting up our routes and views for our server. Well, we're just making a temporary script, so we don't need that stuff right now. Everything app. Okay, so let's sketch out what route and views you want to define. So I think we made some decisions that we want the URL to be human readable out loud, so that somebody who's listening on the telephone can write the URL. We're refraining from using the squigglies and the hyphens. So this, and then we have the name of the slug, if it's been defined. So we could probably let them customize a slug, or we'll slugify the name. So that's the resource, or the automation, name of your automation, I should probably call it that. for now, I like the simplicity of somebody sending something like this without too much other confabulated stuff. So this is the URL structure, and then we also have input. This is the batch name. So let's define those views right now. Move this stuff, sort. Alright, oh, and we have the index, which kind of should show the actual index. Index or home? Well, either way, I'm not sure what's going on here. Oh, it's because paste is on. That's why. Alright, paste is off. Okay, so let's just make a simple server. So same thing here, same concept, just put some dummies. So let's comment out the time-consuming part of it, and just make sure that a server is running properly. Where did I put it? Run batches. No module name pyramid. Yeah, I believe it's serving. Get a hello world. Or batch slug might be better. And then we have the automation batch file. The slug. The batch slug. The whether it's input or output. So variable type, maybe. Is it a variable category or a variable type? And let's see. So we're just defining the routes. For this one, variable path, path name, not sure what to call it. Not really the variable name, it's more like the path. File path, automation batch file. Let's just return a dummy. Serve, check that what we have works. Oh. Check the other routes. I think it's a make something up. Batch, batch name. Okay, and then we have the batch file. Okay, so and we serve a specific file. So what I want, a manual file view. response. This file response actually has to be up here. So returning the file response, somehow we get from the matchdict. But let's just assume that the path is relative to the output folder. Screen that. So then our path here would actually be joining the output folder with the variable path. See if we have any issues. Promising. Sony managed to render one of the variables. Okay. Why is this variable not rendering? We're missing the variable type. Okay, that's working. That means here we're missing the variable type. Okay, and the other question is, why is one of the variable IDs say it's not existent there? So 2D is showing. 1D is not. Oh, it only has one in the beginning. Why is that the case? Oh, because of this variable overlap. I see. We just overrode our variable. Silly errors. Common. port. So CSS we should add later. Restore that. Check that print also works. Good. So let's save what we've done. Clean the notebooks. Document. This, do that, batches, yep. So the next step we need to do is clean up the batches script. So we'll do that next time. Okay, see you folks next time.